Hey folks, I'm Chris, and I'm your Commander Mechanic, here with yet another tuna. But before we get started, I wanted to remind everybody that we're now officially affiliated with our Canadian retailer of choice, Hairy Tarantula. If you want to help support the channel by picking up singles or sealed product, head on over and use the promo code CMDRSPACEMECHANIC at checkout. Now let's see what's in the workshop today. Premium patron Ben Shackelford writes, I'd like you to take a look at my Grixis artifacts list. I built it like a Brea list minus Brea. The deck has a hard time staying alive when people realize I'm assembling a combo, so changes to creatures, mana base, removal, and win cons are appreciated. First, Ben, thank you for supporting the channel. If you would like to support the channel and help us grow and get great goodies like front-of-the-line access to tune-ups, check out our Patreon in the video description. We've got great rewards for supporters at all levels. Ben's list is headed by the partner pairing of Toggo, Goblin Weaponsmith, and Silas Renn, Seeker Adept, making it a Grixis partner offering with emphasis on artifacts. Looking at the commanders, Toggo is an artifact-making machine, giving us rock tokens whenever a land enters the battlefield. We've seen Toggo paired with Kodama of the East Tree to make some infinite combos, so there is a lot of potential. In this list, it's more about giving us artifacts to sacrifice, or tap, or use with some synergistic pieces in the 98 in this case. The other partner is Silas Renn, Seeker Adept. An artifact creature himself, Silas Renn has Death Touch, which makes him great to be defensive or offensive. Especially since dealing combat damage to a player allows you to recast an artifact from your graveyard. This gives us some long-term capabilities and opens up our graveyard as a resource, something I personally love doing. Emry, Lurker of the Lock, can be added in for redundancy here as well. But together, these make for an odd couple, bent on giving us as many artifacts to throw around as possible. Your current list is jam-packed with synergies, everything from infinite combo engines like Basalt Monolith and Rings of Bright Hearth, which generate infinite mana, through to infinite mana outlets like Retrofitter Foundry and Staff of Domination. Note that all of these pieces are artifacts, meaning we can tutor for them, recast them from the graveyard, and ensure that all of our other cards in the deck are centered around getting them and using them. And wow, does the deck have tutors galore. War of Invention, Reshape, and Fabricate all nab us the pieces we need to assemble a combo, with War and Reshape putting the tutored artifacts directly into play. We can't forget Kuldotha Forgemaster either, letting us sacrifice 3 mana rocks or 3 rock tokens, and tutoring up any artifact straight to play. We also have other synergy pieces that can win us the game, backup plans to our core function of assembling one of our combos. Marionette Master can do some serious damage once we start sacrificing artifacts, doming an opponent for 4 or more with each artifact we sacrifice. Combined with treasures from a Dockside Extortionist, that can very quickly knock an opponent out of the game. Speaking of treasures, favorite of mine Revel in Riches is also in the list, providing an alternate win con when we start generating a ton of treasures. Dockside, Revel, and Storm the Vault can all help us generate dozens upon dozens of treasure tokens. And we've even got a classic combo of Time Sieve and Thopter Assembly. If your opponents can't remove Thopter Assembly in a turn cycle, then it alone gives you all the artifacts you need to make infinite turns with Time Sieve. The existing list has lots of little combos, but from what I see, it has a tough time working together. First, and I know this is going to sound odd, but I don't think you're running enough artifacts. Strange, right? Well, you have 17 artifacts, 4 artifact lands, and 10 artifact creatures, Silas Renn included. All told, that's 31 artifacts, 27 of which can be cast. That's 1/3 of your deck that the other non-land 30% of your deck is relying on. Yes, you have other artifact makers in the list, but in reality, it's entirely possible that cards like Mirrodin Besieged, Psymaster Thopterist, and Joyra Weatherlight Captain are duds, Coming down at 3 or 4 mana, they may see you cast one or two artifacts. This isn't a storm list. You aren't using Joyra to combo off. Mirrodin Besieged and Psy both aren't getting you the kind of value you're looking for, and with no self-mill, chances are you'll never win a game off of the back of a Mirrodin Besieged. No, instead, this list is more about quality over quantity. You don't have any landfall enablers to go wide with artifacts with Toggo, so Toggo's only making you one artifact a turn. That's where I think the split in this deck is. Half want you to go wide with a volume of artifacts, and half wants you to go narrow with very specific artifacts. That hurts consistency in the end. I can see your point about survivability too. Once you start tutoring a combo piece or two, you're basically shields down. Your opponents are going to start to sandbag removal and counter magic to prevent you from going off. It's here where we'll want to ensure you can fire right back and protect your pieces. Now, after talking with Ben about his list and the issues that could be observed, he requested we look at how best to focus the deck on going wide with artifacts, as many as possible, in order to take advantage of synergies like Gyarapur Aethergrid or Marionette Master. This means that we may want to cut out some pieces in favor of others. We can still assemble combos, but we'll want to look at ones that make us a volume of artifacts as opposed to give us infinite turns. So cutting something like Staff of Domination and Time Sieve would be decent approaches, in favor of streamlining ways to make more rocks with Toggo, or even make our creatures bigger or artifacts cheaper. Cost reducers are a big part of artifact strategies like this. Aetherium Sculptor is already in, but there's no reason Foundry Inspector can't be in as well. Joyra's Familiar may cost 4, but it's the redundancy that's important. Along the same lines, Chief Engineer gives our artifacts Convoke, turning all of our creatures into mana dorks specifically for artifacts. Very helpful. We could also look at ways to end the game based on a volume of artifacts. Cranial Plating is a great way to do this. Suit up an evasive flyer like Baleful Strix with a plating and easily punch in for 10 plus damage. Saheeli, Sublime Artificer, can not only make us additional artifacts when we cast any non-creature spell, not just artifact non-creature spells, but can also give us another copy of a key combo piece. Having multiples of a card in Commander breaks the core rules and turns into real value. Along that same line, we could include Phyrexian Metamorph, netting us an additional combo piece or win con. Imagine having two Marionette Masters out, or a second Dockside Extortionist. Once we get the volume of artifacts up in your list, adding in a Bolas's Citadel and Mystic Forge would be fantastic. This gives you access to additional cards from your library and, worst case scenario, ensures you can always hit a land drop. Yes, Citadel costs life, but if you're able to very quickly hit combo pieces, it's an all or nothing approach. Let's see how we can add some removal into the list too. Currently, you have a few of the best single target removal pieces like Pongify, Rapid Hybridization, and Reality Shift, which are great. But if we want cards like Revel in Riches to really pay off, we should look at larger scale board wipes. Having Last One Standing in the list can be a double-edged sword. Being unpredictable means, well, you could leave an opponent with their biggest threat. That's bad news. I'm a bigger fan of Fire Covenant. Not only is it an instant, but you get to choose what you're targeting and removing. Again, sure, it costs some life, but look at it as a more focused Toxic Deluge. Black's board wipes are great here too. Deluge, as mentioned, and Damnation, though they're a little pricier. Languish is a better budget option, and I'm a fan of Chain Reaction for when you just want everything gone. For counter magic, you could really go for adding Spell Swindle to the list. Yes, it costs 5 mana, but it can net you a lot of treasures to use on your turn. Again, great for synergizing with your go-wide strategy. Lastly, your mana base. You specifically asked for help making it more consistent. My first comment is that you've got far too many colorless only and comes into play tapped lands. Crypt of the Eternals, Myriad Landscape, and Reliquary Tower are all unnecessary. Adding in the remaining Bond lands, Luxury Suite, and Morphic Pool will really help here, but I understand that these are quickly crawling up over $20 each. In an artifact-heavy deck, Spire of Industry goes a long way. It's a much more affordable version of City of Brass or Mana Confluence. Exotic Orchard should also be in. It's an inexpensive way of ensuring you can make at least one, and at best, all of your colors. You're also only running one Signet in your list. For a deck that wants artifacts and wants to cast artifacts, with no natural way to ramp outside of rituals and artifacts, you should be running more Signets and maybe even the Talismans. Blinkmoth Urn could also be a big player, but the effect is symmetrical. This could easily be making you 10 plus mana a turn before you tap a single permanent. If you're looking to cast lots of spells or fewer big spells, this is a real player for your mana production. One thing to be on the lookout for is anything that shuts off artifacts or activated abilities. A Collector Oofy is your worst nightmare. Make sure that doesn't just kill your deck. Pack removal. Artifact-based creature removal would be ideal since you can tutor for it with your existing inclusions. Duplicant, Noxious Gearhulk, or Meteor Golem are all ways to do this that you can search up and, in some cases, put right onto the battlefield. For upgrades to this list, it is all about consistency, and that comes in the form of tutors. Demonic Tutor, Diabolic Intent, and Vampiric Tutor are your best options for getting what you need when you need it. Grab that Revelin Riches or Dockside and treasures go brrr. Urza, Lord Artificer is another potential inclusion, or even a Pivot Commander. Urza turns all of those treasures and rocks into Mox Sapphires, while also giving you a beefy robot and letting you cast free spells. He is basically everything you want to be doing. Lastly, I know it's prohibitively expensive, but Lion's Eye, Diamond, and Jeweled Lotus are ideal game plans for our commander. They're zero casting cost artifacts that sacrifice themselves and let us recast them with Silas. Even if they sit out without ever being activated, we can later sacrifice them or tap them for value. So I've started by revamping your mana base. You still have a lot of artifact-focused lands in, even though they only produce colorless mana, but you've got a few more lands in now that produce multiple colors. You won't have to be taking turns cracking panoramas or evolving wilds to find your colors, allowing you to play on curve. I've also pulled that curve down a bit by trimming out some of the on-cast trigger cards. Since we want to go wide, we want to be making more tokens and casting fewer spells. Why take a turn off by casting a card that you aren't guaranteed a trigger out of? On that note, we have made it easier for you to cast the artifacts in your list with multiple cost reducers. Best case scenario, you'll have to pay 3 colorless less for artifact spells. And with additions like Bolas's Citadel, it may only cost you a few measly points of life. The deck is still packed with small 2-card combos, but now we have more general synergies to play with. As long as we have a volume of artifacts, we can do something. I hope you like some of the tweaks made to this deck, Ben. Please ensure to let us know in the comments how you've managed to tweak the list. And everyone else, let us know how you would continue to improve on Ben's deck. And if you're interested in helping to support the channel, if you want to become a patron and get a front-of-the-line tune-up, head on over to patreon.com/cmdrmechanic. We appreciate patrons at all levels, and you get good exclusives like fresh deck-building videos, exclusive lists, and access to consulting from me directly. As always, folks, thanks for tuning in, and until next time, good luck and have fun. And a special thanks to our patrons, without whom this content wouldn't be possible. A special shout out to our Lodestone Golems, Ben Frayne, Sterling Lankford, and Will Briggs, and our Metalwork Colossi, Austin Charlotte, Charles Olson, JD, Matthew Chandler, and Ben Shackelford. Thank you, all of you. You make this possible.